Hello, everyone. My name is Markus Bühler. I'm the editor-in-chief for JMBBM, and it's my great pleasure today to introduce Professor Gerhard Holzapfel from the University of Graz and our seminar speaker today, Marco Amabelli. Professor Amabelli will be presenting a lecture today for about an hour, including Q&A, and Professor Holzapfel has kindly agreed to moderate. Gerhard will be introducing the speaker in a little more detail, but I want to thank you both for being here today, the taking the time, and also the audience for attending. Please post your questions in the chat or in the Q&A box in this Zoom panel. If you're watching us on YouTube, you can put the questions in the chat there, and I'll be forwarding these questions on to Gerhard during the Q&A session. That being said, I'm going to hand it over to Gerhard. Your floor is all yours.
Thank you very much, Professor Bühler, and thanks for asking me to moderate this JMBBM Frontiers webinar. It's an honor and a great pleasure to welcome Professor Marco Amabili. Professor Marco Amabili did his master's thesis actually at the University of Ancona. He's very Italian. But he doesn't live in Italy. He works now as a professor at McGill University. He did his PhD at the University of Bologna in Italy. And currently, he's a Canada Research Chair in Vibrations and Fluid Structure Interaction in the Department of Mechanical Engineering at McGill. But he's also an adjunct professor at the University of Parma in Italy. So he authored a course at more than 480 scientific papers in vibrations and applied mechanics, and 230 are published actually in peer-reviewed journals. He wrote two monographs, and the recent one actually, you see, it's sitting on my desk here. It appeared in 2018, and it is a substantial book on nonlinear mechanics of shells and plates in composite, soft, and biological tissues, so published by Cambridge. He's a contributing editor and associate editor of several journals, including the International Journal of Nonlinear Mechanics and the Journal of Fluids and Structures, both by Elsevier. He has actually a long list of awards, honors, and fellowships. I just wanted to mention the awards he received last year. So he was elected a Fellow of the Royal Society of Canada. So he received also the Rochester Reed Warner Medal, which is with respect to his first book he published in 2008 on nonlinear vibration and stability of shells and plates. Then he was elected a foreign member of the Academia Europaea and the European Academy of Sciences. So his research interests are vibration, acoustics, fluid structure interaction, and rather recently, which is nice, Marco, very much involved in biomechanics. So the title of his presentation today is Mechanics and Microstructural Characterization of the Human Aorta. Marco, we are very much looking forward to your presentation. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Gerhard, for the wonderful presentation. And thank you to Markus Bühler for this invitation to present my research. So I'm sharing now my screen with you. So can you see it right now?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, so first of all, I have to say that all what I'm going to present today is clearly a work of a group that is working with me, and also in recent time I've done some cooperation with Gerhard. So you don't have to consider that all these experiments are just done by me. So today I'm going to talk about the mechanical and microstructural characterization of the human aorta. And in particular, I will show you four parts. So the presentation somehow can be divided in four parts. And even if you know that, some of you might know that I like also modeling and nonlinear mechanics, and you know, I'm going to show experimental results. So anything that is not experiments is going to be very much shrinked in this case, in this presentation. So the first part of the presentation is going to deal about microstructural, so will be imaging and quasi-static mechanical characterization of descending thoracic aortas. All these data are for human aortas. The aortas are obtained through Transplant Quebec, which I have to thank a lot for the collaboration. So this means that donors that they donate organs, at the same time, sometimes they sign, they have signed before for donation for research. In that case, the aortas come to me with the same identical procedure of organs donation. So they are at 4 degrees temperature in usually Belzer UV organ preservation solution. They arrive to my lab 2-3 hours maximum, sometimes 30 minutes after they are removed from the body, and these, and they are immediately tested. They can come night, day. Usually I have 8 hours or 12 hours, sometimes 24 hours of advice, I mean of information before they come, because usually these donors are kept alive on, I mean the body is kept alive on machine, reanimation room, but there is a brain death. So in that case, we know in advance and we test it immediately. So this allow us to do tests that usually are not possible. So the number two, second part of the presentation will be about nonlinear dynamics of human aortas for material characterization. And these are experiments in a mock circulatory loop. The third part of the presentation is about a viscoelastic characterization, layer specific, so every single layer of the aorta. And the last part is an ongoing research, will be very, very, very short, to present something that is usually very difficult, which is characterization of the aorta with the smooth muscle activation. So this is possible only for some hours after they are removed from the body. So the first part is the microstructural and quasi-static mechanical characterization. You will see here the name of some of the person of my group. They have collaborated with me. Sample preparation. When we receive these aortas, the first thing that we do is to clean the specimen. So outside there is a kind of jelly type connective tissue, which is removed. We remove the bifurcating branches, the small arteries coming out. In the descending thoracic aortas, the bifurcations are basically infracostal arteries, which are small, and they coming out from the posterior part of the aorta. So this is anterior, this is posterior. This is proximal, which means closer to the heart. This is distal, which means more far. So this is the portion of the aorta that we receive and we prepare. So what we do is we make a longitudinal cut on the posterior part, which is this side, and then we open up the tissue, which becomes like almost a rectangle and is shown here. You see here, this is the anterior part will be in the central area, the posterior will be on the two sides, and in fact on the posterior you see there are these little holes, which are where the bifurcating branches, the small arteries, coming out. Then we punch strips in longitudinal and in circumferential direction on this tissue. They are about 5 millimeters wide. We have punched for that. And the reason why we have more of those, we don't have just one longitudinal, one circumferential, is that some of those strips are dissected, are separated into the three constitutive layers of the aorta, which are called intima, media, and adventitia. So what we do is here is a classical histology with the trichrome stain. So this is the full wall before the separation. Here is where the blood goes. So this is inside the tube. This is the external part. So here we see a first layer, which is called intima. Here we see a central layer, which is called media. And here we see the exterior part of the aorta, which is called adventitia. We see that the thickness of this aorta, this 70-year-old male, is in this case 1.7 millimeters. So here we see, after we split the three layers, we see the intima here, which is in this case 0.23 millimeters. So this is where the blood goes, here where the media was attached. The media is here. This is, in this case, 0.87 millimeters. The red is the smooth muscle. And here we have the adventitia. So we have this layer separation. In some cases, between these layers, we see some transition layer, so an area that is in between the original layer, but I don't go into these details. Now we come to imaging. So the first part of the presentation will show what we do as imaging, and then how we analyze those images to obtain information about the microstructure of the aorta. So we want to investigate two network of fibers, which are the collagen fibers, which are the strongest fiber in the aorta. So they are the main component, if you like, for the strength and the stiffness of the aorta. And then here we have the elastin, which is a kind of software, but is a very interesting network that has a contribution to the mechanical response of the aorta. So the image of the collagen is obtained by histology preparation of sections, of thin section, but they are obtained by a particular type of microscopy, which is called second harmonic generation imaging, and allows to just see the collagen. Looking at the same identical spot, I have this image, which is obtained with the technique called two-photon fluorescence, and these allow to see just the elastin. What is interesting is that the network of collagen and the network of elastin here, they are clearly different. So what is interesting is to use techniques to stack section images and obtain three-dimensional images like this one, where you can see both the collagen and elastin and understand how they are interwined, they are connected to each other. Now, something that is interesting is that you see there are elastin fibers that goes transverse to the collagen fibers, which are the green ones. So the elastin is in red, and some of them, they go together. Some, they have transverse direction. So there are actually transverse connection of the collagen fibers. And I will clarify why this is important very soon. And this will be in for the constitutive modeling. A second investigation that we did to understand how the collagen fibers have lateral interaction of each other is in this atomic force microscopy investigation. This is the adventitia, this is the media, this is the intima. What we can see with atomic force microscope at the scale, which is completely different from the previous one, because in the previous image, you can see these are 500 microns, so it's 0.5 millimeters. So all the image is about 2.5 millimeters. Here, we are a completely different scale. This is 2 micron, this is 500 nanometer, this is 200 nanometers. So we can see that actually the collagen fibers, and here we can see the individual fibrils, have lateral entanglement. So you see here and you see in the cross direction there are fibers, you see it here, you see it here. So at that point, we can see that there is an evidence based on microscopy that not only the load will be carried by collagen fibers along their length, but there will be also lateral forces. What we want to do right now is to study and quantify the information that we have on second harmonic generation images, the ones they show the collagen fibers, about fiber directions. So here we show the direction of those fibers, and we developed the MATLAB code to analyze the fiber orientation, and we weight those fibers for length and thickness. So here I want to clarify something about the microstructure of the aorta, which is not usually all the time well highlighted. The structure of the layers, the three layers of the human aorta, are heterogeneous. So this means that if I look at this area here, this is an adventitia of a 55 years old female. So if I look in this area, I see that the distribution of the collagen fiber directions is indicated here. So zero will be the circumferential direction, which is this direction, and the vertical direction will be longitudinal at 90 degrees. So the fibers in this area, R1, are distributed in this way. In the area R2, they are distributed in this way. In R3, here, you can see those, the fibers are mostly on a diagonal. In fact, they are more or less, I don't know, minus 30 degrees here. In R4, they are different again. If I take the full image, this full image is 2.9 by 2.8 millimeters. The full image picture will be this one. So it really depends in which area you are focusing to get properties, unless you do that, which is what we have done in this study. We study a convergence of the distribution of fibers. So here is a square R1 of dimension 0.5 millimeters. R2, the square side is 1 millimeter. R3 is 1.5. R4 is 2. R5 is 2.5 millimeters. And then the full image is 2.9 by 2.8 millimeters. As you can imagine, the area grows with the square of the side. So there is a much bigger area when we go from 0.5 to 1 millimeter, etc. So here is how we move and how we converge to these results. So this is a good indication that in order to obtain results that we trust, that at least locally in that area of the aorta, this will not be valid if I want to obtain from the thoracic aorta the abdominal aorta, but at least locally results that we can consider meaningful for the tissue, we need to get to image at least 2.5 by 2.5 millimeters, which is the size of the image that we use in this study. At this point, I want to introduce very briefly a constitutive model of the aorta that we used in order to identify the material properties from imaging and from mechanical testing that will be shown after. So the constitutive model that I'm going to use here comes from a work of the group of Professor Rozafel, and this has been refined by his group through the years. There will be just a little bit difference that I will show you at the very end. But let's start step by step. So the strain energy density function is composed of two parts in this model. One part is isotropic and describe the ground matrix and basically the elastin. So is this contribution. And the second contribution in this constitutive model comes from the collagen fibers. Therefore, here is the part related to the collagen fibers, and here these are coefficients that are identified by the mechanical testing, and here actually is a structural part that contains the invariance of the right Cauchy-Green deformation tensor, and it contains, which are I1, I4, and IN, and it contains two dispersion parameters, which are parameters that describe the dispersion of the collagen fiber direction in an in-plane section of the aorta and in a cross-section, the one that is called out-of-plane dispersion in the aorta. So in this type of constitutive model, you need imaging and analysis of those imaging in order to obtain those parameters. In addition to that, you will have an angle, which is alpha here, which indicate the average direction of a family of collagen fibers. So those two dispersion parameters, the in-plane and the out-of-plane dispersion parameter, through the work of Professor Rozafel, has been assumed to have a von Mises distribution, and those parameters are obtained from these two equations. Now, the only somehow difference here is that we assume to have a number of families of collagen fibers. And in particular, we found from imaging that we need just actually one family of collagen fibers to describe the images that we have. Only we need to obtain the dispersion from images. One family will be enough, but we always need to introduce a second family to represent the cross link and the entanglement of these collagen fibers. So basically we have one family and then an orthogonal family, which is virtual. We don't get that from imaging, at least not at the scale of second harmonics generation images, but we need to go, as we saw before, to a much smaller scale. So we don't quantify that. We introduce these. We have constrained that this second virtual family has much smaller mechanical characteristics, but has to be there in order to represent the mechanical tests and also these lateral interaction and cross-link. So now I'm going to start presenting you some results of our image analysis and mechanical testing. So here is a media. So this is an image of about 2.5 by 2.5 millimeters, circumferential longitudinal direction. You see the collagen fibers. This is the analysis of this image. This is the distribution. In red is the experiment. In black is the fitting model with the von Mises distribution. And this gives the parameter that we called kappa in plane. So is the in plane dispersion of the collagen fibers. This actually comes from this image. Here is a cross section of the same aorta. You see here the intima, you see the adventitia, you see the media. So in order to do that, we cancel the media, we cancel the adventitia, we cancel the intima, we make an analysis of the media, and we get this distribution of fibers. As you can see, they are much more aligned in the cross section than the in-plane section in a very dramatic way. So the out-of-plane dispersion parameter will be different and significantly different than in-plane. Here instead, I'm showing you the mechanical characterization. So the mechanical characterization is obtained on just media. So after the splitting of the layers, this is the result of, sorry, these are the results on the circumferential strip. These are the results of the longitudinal strip. And the red are experiments. The black is the fitting. Who has done fitting of mechanical tests by using constitutive model knows how difficult it is to get this quality of fitting, which is beautiful. And we have a software based on genetic algorithm for optimization and identification of the coefficients of the constitutive model in order to get that. But also, is due to the quality of the constitutive model. And this is based on data from imaging. And the fact to use only two families of fibers, one in this case is in the circumferential direction and comes from imaging with this dispersion. The other one is orthogonal to that and is virtual to describe these cross-link and entanglement and lateral interaction allows us to get this quality of fitting. This is the adventitia. Somebody can say, oh, your media is easier to describe than adventitia. No, we are really good results here for the adventitia too, in this case. And intima is the most difficult. Yes, true. And these are the in-plane distribution. This is the cross-section distribution. And this is the fitting. Again, I would say really very good. So We were able to, using the information from the images, to fit the mechanical testing that we did on the three layers with the constitutive model, obtaining quite significant results. Now, one question that can come to everyone, but the data that you get from imaging are for a section of the aorta. But, you know, if you move through the thickness, what changes? So this is the question that has been analyzed here. So we took, in this case, there is a media, which is, you know, almost a millimeter thick. And we took many sections, and we analyzed images through the sections. So here is the in-plane dispersion parameter versus the distance from the membrana elastica interna. And so this is the results. And here on the right is the angle giving the mean direction of the fiber family, which is in this case is around 90 degrees, which means in longitudinal direction. And you see that these data change little through the thickness. And in the point called C1, C2, and C3, I show the full histograms here. And you see that these histograms are very similar. So actually, the information that we get from those images are quite consistent to the thickness. Now, here is a statistical analysis made on 13 donors. So this means 13 intima, media, and adventitia, which are tested in both directions, so in axial and circumferential direction. And here we see the in-plane dispersion parameters, and we see that the media is the less dispersed statistically, and a similar dispersion is observed for the intima and adventitia. This is for in-plane. And for the cross-section, so we see that actually in that case, 0.5 means perfectly aligned. We see that the media is the most aligned, and actually with remarkable values, which is 0.46, 0.47, et cetera, statistically. Then we have, as a second most aligned in the cross-section, is the intima, and the most dispersed is the adventitia. And this actually has been seen in the images, because as you can see here, you see that the fibers in a cross-section are very well aligned for the media, aligned well enough, or at least enough for the intima, but for the adventitia, you see there is not the same type of alignment that you see for the media. So these are interesting results. Now, we tested also the full wall. It means the three layers together. These are mechanical tests showing the engineering stress versus the engineering strain. This has not been converted to other stresses like second Kirchhoff-Piola. This is not done yet. But anyway, these are the specimens that we tested in circumferential and longitudinal direction. And what is interesting is to take here one reference level and see what's the second stiffness is versus the age, because these are all different donors, so they have different age. So if I make this correlation between the age of the donor and the second stiffness, this is average between the two directions. We see the experimental point in red, and we see the correlation. Here we have the p-value 0.042. This is the correlation coefficients. This is the linear regression. And it seems that there is really a stiffening of the wall with age, which is not a new result, but is something that is very important. And I will speak about that a little later on. Hopefully, I will have enough time to discuss. Here is actually the effect of age on the dispersion parameters. The only one which seems really significant is this one, which indicates that actually, with time, the in-plane dispersion parameter of intima decreases. Actually, we know that with time, intima becomes thicker and stiffer in humans, which is a disadvantage. And the changes in the intima are observed also in the in-plane dispersion parameter. You see the p-value is very low. So it seems really that there is an effect of age over there. Residual stresses, I have no time. I'm not discussing residual stresses today. I want to show you now the second part of the presentation, which is shorter likely, about testing the full aortas. The full aortas means the full descending thoracic aorta in a mock circulatory loop. So this is what actually the components that we use in our circulatory loop. We have a pulsatile pump, is actually an Harvard machine. We have two expansion chamber, a test section, and here there is heating and reservoir tank. So in the test section, we put the aorta, we have a magnetic flow meter, we have a catheter pressure sensor before and after the test section. And we use the laser Doppler sensor to measure the dynamic displacement. We use four of them. And the reason of four is to have the motion or the displacement in two orthogonal directions, but also to distinguish axisymmetric from bending oscillations, which are shown here. This is a hysteresis loop of the diameter change versus pressure. This is the tests are in physiological regime, so between, let's say, 80 and 120 millimeters of mercury of pressure. And this is a full cycle. And basically, the area inside this cycle is proportional to the lost energy in a cycle. And the sum, the average of S1 and S2 areas, these two areas, is proportional to the storage energy. So the ratio of the two allow us to obtain the so-called loss factor. And the loss factor is a quantification of the dissipation of energy in a cycle. This dissipation is due to both material and fluid structure interaction. So we will see that these parameters increase a lot with the pulse rate, because the flow part becomes important when we change the flow rate, because the heart can run from 60 BPM, more or less, to 180 or even 200 BPM. BPM is beat per minute. So in this range, we have significant changes in this dissipation. And the storage modulus actually is related to the stiffness, which is viscoelastic stiffness, because dynamic load changes the stiffness of the aorta, increasing it. So the aorta is more stiff for a dynamic load than for a static load, is obtained here from the slope of this red line in the middle of the loop. So here is a video that shows how much the aorta can expand under cyclic pressure load, which is physiological pressure load. And this is the time response at 60 BPM, so basically at rest, And here we studied from 60 to 180 BPM. Anyway, we see here the pressure. And what is interesting is that our MOX circulatory loop can even reproduce here the dichrotic notch. And here is the flow. So here instead we have the pressure again in blue. You see the pressure is two lines because it's measured before and after the aorta. And the red, also two lines, is the dynamic displacement of the aorta at the center in the axisymmetric mode. So is the expansion of the diameter and is measured in the two orthogonal directions. And you see it's very similar in this case. And here is actually the bending component. The bending component is not so important. Here it's dynamic analysis of the bending component in the human body because the aorta is connected to several branches coming out and there is connective tissue touching. So it will be much more damped any bending oscillation. So I'm not talking about bending right now. Here is the effect of the pulsation on the hysteresis loop. You see how much it changed, 60 BPM, 100, 170 BPM, and the dissipation changes a lot. Here is a study of the effect on three age groups that we tested, 30 to 44 years, 45 to 59, 60 to 85 years, about the parameters that we identified. Here is the diameter change of the aorta divided by the original diameter. So it shows how much the aorta expand during each heart beating. Now, this phenomenon is extremely important. I'm going to show you this result. You see the change in the aorta expansion versus age is dramatic. The correlation is also particularly good. You know, 0.01 is, for example, a threshold. This is extremely sure that there is a strong dependence between the diameter change of the aorta and age. These red data are from literature, is a classical study from some Stanford investigator that analyzed the same thing, but in vivo, not ex vivo as we did us, and they are in good agreement. So what I want to say is that a young aorta, this 30 years of age, expand about more than 8%. During the physiological at-rest regime, so between 80 and 120 BPM, this is a very important thing for the perfusion, for the blood circulation, because the function of the aorta is to accumulate blood during the systole and to release it during the diastole. So in this way, it smoothens the pulsatile nature of the flow. So these improve, make the flow more uniform, which is very important in the human body. So making the aorta stiffer is negative. In fact, age does that, and this usually age doesn't help our aorta or our circulatory system. But this comes extremely important for design of a future generation of grafts, because the grafts that are used right now to replace aortas in case of large aneurysm or acute aortic dissection are made in Dacron. This is extremely stiff in circumferential direction and does not expand basically at all. So it kills all these expansion effects, which is very important to improve the flow. Also, it creates waves that goes back to the heart. So our new generation of aortic prostheses need to mimic the natural behavior of the aorta. So all this information that we are gathering from testing needs to be taken into account. Now, I know I have very little time, so I skip this part. And I just say that what we are doing right now is activation of the smooth muscle. This is an ongoing research. I have only a couple of slides to show you. So all what we talked before is the passive behavior of the aorta. But the aorta is muscle, and muscle can be activated by adrenaline in the body. And this makes the aorta to become smaller and stiffer. This is very difficult to test normally because the aortas that you get are not able to, are basically, you cannot activate the smooth muscle anymore. We are very lucky, lucky to have aortas where we can activate the smooth muscle because they are kept into organ preservation solution and for a very short time. Every single test that we do, as I show you in the next slide, requires 3 hours. So we are able to complete test in the two directions before the specimen goes bad and we cannot activate it anymore. We use potassium chloride, so KCl, for a first part of the activation. And then we use noradrenaline to reach the full saturation, to reach the maximum force that we can generate in the axial strip. And these are not irrelevant forces, are quite significant. And as you can see, we can do that on the circumferential and longitudinal strip. Most of people think that the activation of smooth muscle will work only in the circumferential direction. So we do quasi-static test, we do dynamic test. This is before the activation, then we do the activation, and then we repeat them. And these are the static curves before the activation and after the activation. I finish here. So all the meaning of this study is to build a database of material parameters for aortas under static and dynamic loads that can be used to design future graphs that will be able to mimic the mechanical behavior of the aorta. So thank you very much for your attention.
Yes, thank you so much, Professor Amabile, for this very instructive presentation on the static, dynamic, and active behavior of tissue, focusing in particular on the microstructure. I think this is certainly something we will hear in the future more, in particular on the microstructure and on the activation. And let me look up in the chat if there are any questions. There is one. Do you see age-related differences? Okay, this is already answered, if there are any age-related differences on the mechanical properties. There's another question coming in. As you know, we implemented via Abacus numerical modeling of the out-of-plane fiber distribution, and now we started to try to model the damage. Regarding that, what do you think could be the damage mechanism accounting for age? An increasing stiffness could seem to be a good fact, but we know it is not. This is a message I read in the chat. Could you say a couple of words to that message, Marco?
Yes, so it seems that age has an effect on both the stiffness, but also on the microstructure. At least the microstructure of the intima seems to be changed. So intima is usually, because intima is the layer that is in contact with the blood, so is a layer which has a very important function, is to avoid that the blood goes in touch with the next layer, which is the media. So if a damage occurs in the intima, which is a very thin layer, which can be of the order of 0.1 millimeters, if a damage appears there, So a damage we usually model as a crack. So if the blood is able to reach the media is unable to support the contact with the blood in the sense that the blood is a flow that has particles. And these particles will be able to dissect the media, creating the so-called acute aortic dissection. So we don't want to have damage on the intima, and the initiation of damage to the intima, I think, is a particularly important point. And if the intima changes stiffness, but also microstructure with age, then everything becomes more possible.
Thank you. Let me add something here. I think this is an important topic. We have to think about how to model damage. And even more important is how to characterize damage at a certain load level. Of course, the more you stretch up, the more you damage. But aging probably is not related to damage at all. But for, let's say, the aortic dissection or for therapies like balloon angioplasty, you induce damage, but we have to characterize that, and it may not be isotropic. So this would be certainly a very important extension of my model, which we published in 2015, to add damage. But I think, again, we need more experimental data on that. Are there any other questions? I don't see any more. No, there's one. Let me check. Well, there's an anonymous attendee, and he, she writes, you showed collagen fibers angles of 90 degrees towards the axial direction in the media. Many studies showed fiber angles mainly in the circumferential direction. Could you comment on that? I also have some ideas on that, but Marco, go ahead.
Yes. Okay. So let me go back to that part of the presentation. Sorry, I have to do that. So in this media here, the fibers are mostly in the circumferential direction, as you can see. So this angle is zero, and even visually, you see that most of the fiber are in circumferential direction in this media. This is a male, 39 years old. This is not always the case. So here you see significant dispersion. So it means that not all fibers are in circumferential direction, but you have some that are in axial, or let's say, actually, I call it here longitudinal direction, but, you know, mostly of fibers are in circumferential direction. But this is not always the case. So we have here done some statistical analysis, which shows that, yes, circumferential is more common, but is not so rare to see, even in the media, the main family of fibers to be longitudinal.
Okay, thank you, Marco. So, Karina Martinez-Villegas, thank you very much. Thank you for your presentation. And she writes, you briefly mentioned that adrenaline indicates to stiffen the aorta. Is this a long-term effect, she writes. Can you please explain further this part?
Yes. So, basically, the activation, so here maybe I can say a few words more. Okay, so the activation of the smooth muscle is obtained in these Krebs Ansley buffer solution, which is at 37 degrees, but is also bubbled. Bubbled means that there are oxygen bubbles that we put there. So you need to have oxygen in order to obtain the activation of this tissue, because in the human body there is not necessity because there is blood coming there. But since there is no blood, you need to have a solution that brings all the nutrients so that this is possible. Now, in order to induce the contraction, we have here two vasoactive agent. The first one is KCL, which is known to be to induce contraction of the muscle, and then we use noradrenaline. All these effects are not permanent. They are, as long as you keep the chemical there, which in our case is about 1 hour and a half of time. So when you wash the tissue well, you will remove this effect. So when the chemical is removed, the effect is removed. So it's not permanent.
Okay. So Nicholas Distasio from McGill writes, could you apply the same analysis to the aortic arch? Well, you probably would have to do, it's a different geometry, but now the question comes where you would find changes as a result of, say, atherosclerosis. Do you have an idea of how the structure properties may be different there? Well, with atherosclerotic plaques, that's a different issue, I think.
Yeah, the aorta is actually a long artery, as you can see here. You know, it starts from the heart. Obviously, there is the ascending part, which is this one. This is the arch. This is the thoracic descending aorta, which is the portion that has been studied, and then the abdominal. One thing that changes the geometry here, there is a significant curvature here. It's almost straight. And another thing is the thickness, because on this part here, there are three branches coming out, so about one third of the blood that is pumped by the heart goes out here. So here, there are only two-thirds of the blood. If you come down here, there is only 10% of the blood left because it's coming out from other branches. So the thickness, the dimension changes, and the diameter, basically, of the aorta changes. So there are changes, clearly, in the geometry, in about the structure. You need to make, you cannot say the structure is the same, the orientation of the fibers is the same. If you don't do the study, you don't really know. Even if there are probably not dramatic changes, the changes are much smaller than what we might think. What is actually instead a dramatic difference is the behavior of the human aorta anywhere we want and the one of Dacron grafts. So Dacron grafts are stiff in the sense that the diameter expansion is basically zero. When the aorta expands for a young individual, about 10%. So the main point is that we cannot accept at this stage to use a prosthesis that has been developed 30 years ago that are still used because they are compatible some people, they think they are fine, but actually they are not fine because they create problems to the heart and to the perfusion.
Okay, so another question came up by Ivan. She wants to know the activation difference of the potential of the smooth muscle. So, and does it change the elastin contribution or distribution in the aortic layers?
So the activation, obviously, you will need to add a term in the constitutive model to describe the activation part. So in order so there will be an extra term in the potential that you have to do to use there. About changes in the structure of elastin or collagen, no, in the sense that we basically there will be more fibers which include the smooth muscle that will take load, but the structure will not change otherwise.
Okay, I think that was about the last question, what was posted. So, and this is also time now maybe to close this session. So we have just spent about an hour, which was planned to do. So let us all thank for the very illustrative and instructive presentation of Professor Marco Amabili. And let me also thank Professor Markus Bühler, who actually had the initiative to bring us together this morning or this afternoon, depending on where you are sitting at the moment. So I wish you a very nice day and have a good week. And thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Amabili, for a great presentation and Professor Holzapf for moderating the seminar. And I enjoyed the presentation a lot myself, and we had some really great questions. Thank you all. With that, we'll be closing this webinar for today. We have several more webinars coming up the next couple of months, so stay tuned for the announcements on Twitter. If you are interested in speaking, please reach out to me. If you have recommendations for speakers, reach out to me. With that, I want to thank you all for your support of the webinar series, for the journal, and I hope to see you soon. Bye.
Bye, thank you very much. Bye.